Today on the show, the pleasure of speaking with Adam Adams. Adam is the host of the Creative Real Estate Podcast and the founder of Blue Spruce Holdings. The journey for Adam started way back in 2005 when he took the plunge, like most of us, into part-time real estate investing. However, quickly, that became his full-time passion. Today, Adam is partnered in 7 multifamily syndications with approximately 1,400 doors, slightly valued over $100 million. His company, Blue Spruce Holdings, focuses on finding and managing apartment communities to allow investors diversification of cash flow, tax benefits, and time freedom, which is the most important thing we all crave, right? Adam's primary role in the company is to attract capital, successfully raising millions of dollars from private investors. I'm really excited and pumped to have him on the show today, but enough out of me. Let's get him out here. G'day, Adam. Welcome to the show. How are you doing today, mate?
I'm fantastic. How are you?
Mate, I'm even better talking to you, big fella. It's Friday. Where are you dialing in from?
Conifer, Colorado, up in the mountains, not too far from Denver.
Nice. Nice. How's the weather up there? Are you surviving COVID and all this sort of stuff?
We're barely surviving COVID and the weather's okay. It's chilly. It's chilly. Probably 40 degrees.
Wow. Okay. So still, it hasn't hit the summer yet. It's here in Los Angeles, it started to warm up a little bit. So it's good. I'm glad the summer's just around the corner. Mate, the first question I ask all my guests when we dive into the show is rewind the clock and tell me how you made your first ever dollar as a kid.
First ever dollar happened when I was 5 years old. And my stepdad, we just moved in with him, and my parents were engaged. He and my mom were engaged, and he owns a tree farm. Mm-hmm. And on the tree farm we had just thousands of trees. And so it was one day I was only 5 years old, and he said that I needed to start learning how to be a man. Like, I was like, okay. And so what I did was I got sunburnt watering all of those plants. So we had the longest hoses you've ever seen. And I got paid $1 an hour, to water those plants. And so my first ever dollar as a kid happened, getting sunburnt watering trees on the farm.
Mate, hard manual labor is definitely a way of valuing a dollar, because so I guess how many years did you spend growing up laboring on the farm, watering trees, planting trees, just doing the hard yakka?
I grew up, so 5 years old all the way till I was 15. And at 15, I decided to go work at Burger King. Mm-hmm. Because I was like, I'm not working outside anymore. I can't get in the sun. It makes me sick. It's too hot. I hate being hot. Like, just,
really?
I live up here in Conifer because it's 10, 12 degrees colder than it is in Denver. So we're up at 8,400 feet versus 5,200 feet. So anyway, that way I can sleep where it's cold and I don't have to be out where it's too hot. But back then, I decided, you know what, I'm going to get an indoor job. So as soon as I am old enough, you couldn't get a job until you were 15 in, mm-hmm. in Utah back in that time. So as soon as I was old enough, I said, I'm out of here. And so I started working at fast food restaurants.
Flipping burgers.
Yeah. Yeah.
So mate, fill in the gap. You know, we spoke about in the introduction what you're doing today, but like, where did that all come from? And did you go to uni? Did you have a trade? Like, where did all this entrepreneurial spirit come from over the years?
It probably came from my dad. My dad wanted me to read Rich Dad, Poor Dad. Ever since it came out, like, he's an avid reader. He's always reading. And this book came out, it you know, opened up his mind a little bit. He was already an entrepreneur and he was already an investor. So we owned land and agriculture all over. We owned multifamily. So that I grew up owning multifamily when I was about 9 is the first time I ever collected rent. I was 8 or 9 years old and I collected rent from one of our multifamilies because someone was late and he couldn't be home in time to collect it. So that's really where that came from. You asked if I went to university. I did end up going to university. And while in college, my dad bought me a piece of land, 2005. I was able to make a 12,000% return on that land in 2 years. More money than I had ever seen. I was in college and I was bartending. and you make maybe like $100 a shift, $120, something like that. And all of a sudden I netted like $12,000 or something. And that was more than I had seen in a whole year on this piece of land after paying commissions and stuff like that. So I was hooked. My dad bought it for me, but I left this part out on accident. His CPA made me buy it from him. Like after he gave it to me, he was like, actually, I can't give it to you. You have to buy it. So I paid for it. And I thought that was a terrible 2005 Christmas present, but I finally owned a piece of America. When I sold it 2 years later, I started actually managing property, because I found out that Robert Kiyosaki, in that book that I read, I found out later on that he actually made his wealth not with single family, but with multifamily. So he was running his business, and he was investing in multifamily. And so I said, I'm skipping single family too. So I went straight from land to property management. And then in 2008, I bought my first apartment building. So, which didn't turn out so well in 2008, but that's okay. It's totally other story. Fast forward, when I finally got my tail out of my legs in 2015, I got back into tax deed investing, buying. I did all sorts of stuff on tax deeds. So that's how I got back into it about 5 years ago. Some properties I made a lot of money on. I doubled money on two or three properties. And then I ended up losing about $5,000 on a property during a hurricane that I owned in Florida that I had to lose the money because it was in process, in progress, and it was like taken apart. And as the hurricane was coming through, I was told that by the city of Sebastian, it's a city out in Indian River County, but they said, look, if you don't demo this property, we're going to demo it for you. So I hurried and paid for somebody to demo it. And we had to sell it during the hurricane for a loss. So it was the first one I ever lost money on. But brings us to starting to syndicate about 3 years ago. And it started off slow. My first deal took 8 months to syndicate. Almost could have had a baby. and the next one closed about a week or two later, maybe 3 weeks later. So they, you know, what's his name? Michael Blanc always talks about law of the first deal. Mm-hmm. And so fast forward 3 years, we've closed on 7 total syndications.
That's awesome. Well, mate, massive background in real estate, and seeing that you had a bit of a hiccup, it sounds like, in 2008, but to come back and dust your knees off and get back on the horse, it takes a few of those to know what you're doing and how to make it better the next time around, right? So I'm sure those lessons that you learned along the way were not in vain, and applied them to your portfolio today. So well done. I want to dive into what we were speaking a little bit about in the green room, really what about your passion is in when it comes to real estate investing. And what I discovered, which was, I've known you for a little while now, that you're really passionate about building communities, building podcasts, building meetups, building a brand. So let's start there and talk. Let's talk about the branding side of it. And, you know, I love branding just as much as the next bloke. But what's the importance of having a good personal brand? And maybe you don't even think that a personal brand is good, but what's the important step to take when you're first starting out to wanting to brand yourself as a, not necessarily a thought leader, but maybe a key person of influence in your own sphere? Where do you start?
Yeah. Well, you did say a personal brand. And I think that's really important because, in my opinion, people aren't doing business with logos so much these days. They're usually doing business with people that they like. So with a personal brand, I think people are usually going around and approaching it at the wrong angle. When they're trying to do the personal brand, they think that they need to build their business brand, and they think that they need to, jam education down people's throats. They think that they need to jam, ideas down people's throats. I think it's a lot different than that. I think to really build a personal brand where people can start connecting with you, you shouldn't be building up the business. You should just be showing people who you are to the core. So in my opinion, when I help other people, you know, launch podcasts or launch, get on social media, I talk to them about making sure that they understand their own story first. Like, what is your story? What do you like? Are you big into wine? Are you big into CrossFit? How about running or yoga? Or are you a big foodie? Or do you love geeking out, watching movies? Whatever it is, you think about some of those things, because people want to see somebody who's real and well-rounded. So you start to try to build who you are, just share it with the world, be the light beacon that just kind of shows people exactly who you are. People get deep into this and they start thinking, I've got every post has to be about business, or every post has to have a call to action, or everything that I do has to be about my business. I would say maybe 20% of it does. The other 20 is you're talking about your kids. You're talking about the salsa lessons you're doing with your sweetheart. You're talking about enjoying this special kind of wine from this one region, and you studied about it and you learned all about it. And as you people start seeing, like, oh, he's a CrossFitter also. I love CrossFit, and that they're going to be tied to you, and others who hate CrossFit aren't. So you're talking about yoga or CrossFit or whatever it is that you do. That's what I mean by building a personal brand, is allowing people in, like opening up the doors and showing them who you really are. And some of your posts, about 20% of it's going to be about the finance if you're syndicating deals. So if your goal is to syndicate deals, bring in passive investors, for instance, every now and again, you've got to post about how important that finances are and how important passive investing is. But you got to be speaking to your exact avatar the right way, so that so that you're in their shoes, putting yourself in their shoes and answering the questions that they want to know. And so that's, I think, building a personal brand is incredibly important. And I think that people generally go at it a little bit wrong. And if they think that the personal brand is personal, they're going to have a lot better results.
Yeah, things that come to mind when you say stuff like that is two things. One thing is that it seems like we're all starting, and we're in this world of personal branding, but we're essentially creating really a lifestyle business first. Like, that could morph into a corporation or, you know, a big, you know, you're talking about logos before, but I think starting with intrinsically who you are, and so people get to know, like, and trust you, because, you know, when they invest with, particularly in real estate, when they invest with you, they're investing in you first and foremost. The deal's sort of secondary. Yeah. The second piece that I wanted to bring to that was, I heard a quote one time, and I'm not going to be able to remember the person's name, but I do remember the quote. And the quote was, being different is better than being better. And so what that means to me is, like, you don't just have to be better. You don't have to try and beat Adam Adams or Reed Goossens or the next bloke, but you've got to be different. And being different is good, because you spoke about the CrossFit. You know, you're in a CrossFit, cool. Oh, some other people go, screw CrossFit, you jock, you know, whatever. You're not going to attract those people. And that's good, because you're using that personal brand and what you love and feel to attract people who you want to do business with, right? And sort of in itself, it's going to weed out all the people you don't want to do business with. And that's because the message of the personal branding is coming through, because it's, you get to go to the core of who you are and what makes you tick. Right. Yeah. So I think that quote to me, always being different is better than being better. Any comments or thoughts on that?
Well, it's because it really shows that we all know that there's more. If, let's just say, the listener wants to attract private capital. Let's just assume that for a second. We all know that there's more money out there than there is deals. There's by far more money than you could ever use than there is deals, but there's a lot that's untapped. And if I try to start another podcast that's exactly your podcast, your everything, and I even copy your accent and everything like that, well, I'm not helping anyone.
Right.
So if I can find my niche and create a niche that's not already there, then I'm attracting a certain type of person, and there's more than enough money for everybody. We could have thousands and thousands of syndicators and still have too much money for the amount of deals that are out there.
Talk to me a little bit about this idea of the marketing piece. So we spoke about the personal brand. Yes, you want to create a story about who you are, and I think that's really important. But then going out and using different channels. And then the channels, we talked about podcasting. I know you're heavily involved in Meetup. There's blogging, there's newsletters. How does one determine what's the best channel for them to go out and essentially have a megaphone to preach their story and their who they are and what makes them tick? What do you say to those folks?
Well, there's got to be one that you resonate with. What, there's a lot of people that are listening that don't resonate with any because they're just afraid. Like they would have resonated with one, but there's something holding them back. So to that person, I would just say, this is pretty important. Like Reed probably raises tens of millions of dollars a year because he has a podcast. So like, I know that I have people logging in and jumping onto our passive investor list every single week we get more and more, and I don't have to go out and have conversations. So, mm-hmm. So by something you said, Reed, earlier, you said, know, like, and trust. They gotta know you, like you, and trust you. Now, if you're not authentic, they can't like you or trust you. They just can't. There's no way that they would believe that you are going to perform what you say you're going to perform if you're not an authentic person. But the know you part is also really important, because if five people know you, like you, and trust you, then great. You might do business with two or three or four or five people. But if 10,000 people or even 1,000 know you, like you, and trust you, you're probably going to be doing business with 20, 30, 40, 50, 100 different people. And so if you're skipping out on the branding, if you're skipping out on having something like a blog or a Facebook group or a podcast or a workshops that you host around passive investing, then it's going to be really hard for people to even know who you are. Right. The few that do, they're going to be connected, but you're not going to hit your goals until you do that. So you asked, how do you select which one to do? And in my opinion, one of those, once you get over the fear of and knowledge that you got to do something, now it just goes with what resonates the most with you. Does hosting a weekly or a monthly meetup resonate with you? Does it feel good to kind of be the life of the party and put it all together? Maybe a podcast, because it's simple, it's easy. You could do it from your underwear and nobody would know, you know, and maybe
except you
like
video.
That. Well, even on video, the bottom half doesn't have to show. Or do you want to do a YouTube? Like, do you love getting in front of a camera? Because if you do, YouTube would be a phenomenal way for you to start growing that influence. Blogs work really, really well. And a lot of the people that read blogs are very sophisticated people. So it's your choice, but you got to figure out which one kind of resonates with you. I help a lot of people with podcasting. That's kind of the one that I personally love myself. But you can get just the same amount of value by being a Facebook group leader. Like, you start your own Facebook group, and then you can be on there for 2 hours a day or 10 hours a day, and you'll be pulling in a lot of your target avatar, I call it, passive investors. If you want to raise money, or if you were like a coach, a mentor, you'd be pulling in the right people there. Or if you had a product to sell. Some of my clients are attorneys. I have a couple of securities attorneys that work with me that I just help them brand, help them get out in front of people. But however it is, you got to figure something. Mm-hmm. Your personal Facebook page, maybe hosting dinners. Let's just say all of the others are hard. At least hosting small dinners, like where there's four potential investors that are going to sit with you. There's more ideas that could resonate with you. You just got to figure out which one you're willing to do. And if none of them do, that just means you got to partner with someone like Reed, right? You got to partner with somebody who's willing to do it.
Right. And I think the big thing you're talking about there is finding what resonates with you in order to go out and maximize it. And I remember, when I you know, speak with people about the different ways in which you can start to have a bit of a megaphone. The analogy I use is, you know, start with a monthly newsletter. It's simple. It's easy. It's not, it doesn't take a lot of time. Yeah. Podcasting takes a lot of time. You know, being in front of the YouTube, in front of a channel for YouTube takes a lot of time with lighting and making sure you look, you know, bags under your eyes. Like there's a lot of things that go into it. And I've done all of them, right? I tried a little bit of each, and actually podcasting was the best because it was able, I was able to do it from my home or my studio, and I was able to reach so much more people or listeners than I was doing my meetup or doing YouTube. So, and the other thing I want to add to that is the consistency piece, because a lot of people get into this world of trying to have a brand or trying to take their business to the next level, but they're not consistent with it. They don't understand the consistency. So talk a little bit about what you try to teach with your consistency, because that's the real important key in my mind. Like there's obviously taking the leap of faith and just doing it. But then you got to do it consistently. Completely. Otherwise, it's not going to work. It just will never work.
So remember I told you I was watering plants when I was five. I don't remember how old I was in this story. Maybe 6 years old, 7 years old. But there's thousands of plants, and I was watering them, and it was one of those days that I just felt like I just got way too hot. It was July, it was Utah in the desert, and I was just like, I'm done. And I thought to myself, you know, I helped my dad out because I watered half the plants, and I thought, oh, hey, I already made $2, and I don't want to be out here with the crappy weather for another 2 hours. It's just, I was done. So I went home, and actually my stepdad said, Adam, like, how did you do that so fast? Like, there's no way you could be done already. And I was like, yeah, I just literally decided to quit. And that day, I learned a lesson on the discussion that you were just saying, on the same topic you were just saying. That is the day that I learned a lesson. I learned it the hard way because my dad really reamed me. He said, if you don't ever start something, you don't tell me you're going to do something and then you don't do it. Like integrity, follow through is too important. And so it takes me to my first ever meetup group. I remember thinking to myself when I was creating that meetup in 2016, I remember saying to myself, I promise that I'm going to do this for a year, every single week on Thursdays during lunch. And if I'm the only one there, I'll just have lunch by myself and, you know, bring my laptop. So I remember committing to that, and I had my dad in mind. And the next day, a couple of days later, I was actually driving to the meetup, and we had a huge snowstorm. It snowed about 10 inches in like 2 or 3 hours. It was insane. And as I was driving to the meetup, it was at a Smashburger. I kept thinking to myself, like, it would be so easy to cancel this. Like, it snowed. Snow was ridiculous. I should just message people. I'd actually said to myself, I'll probably be helping them. I'll probably be helping them because I'll save their lives because they won't have to drive in this. And I kept thinking about that, but it was literally my dad, that story of watering plants, that brought me to say, I'm just going to go. I said I would do it every single week. And it was not easy, but that first day that I went there, and there was four people. There was only four people that came. There was me, my partner, and four others. And I actually partnered with two different people in there. I've made thousands and thousands and hundreds of thousands of dollars with two of the people that attended there. And to me, it's just knowing that if you start something, you got to follow through, because if I didn't go that day, though it was snowing, it was 10 inches of snow. If I would have turned around, if I would have not gone, those four people would have probably said, oh, he's not consistent, he doesn't follow through, and they never would have partnered with me, and they never would have trusted me to come to another meetup. And so it's so essential for anyone who's starting something with podcasting. If you stop, if you hold off for a while, iTunes algorithms jump on that and they say, okay, stop sending this. So when you get back to consistent, you've already lost it. You've already lost it. You've already lost your listeners. Your listeners are already listening to someone else's show. if you're at a meetup, they've already decided to go to somebody else's meetup. So to me, consistency and follow through is one of the most important things. In fact, I only have one tattoo, and it's persistence, determination equals endless potential. But there's some symbols. But I think that if you're thinking that you might want to start a meetup, you got to do it for at least 3 years. If you're thinking you're going to start a podcast, you got to do it for at least 3 years, because the value that you get is slow in the beginning. Like, at least that's how it was for my podcast and my meetup. It was like a bell curve. So just, you got to understand that if you're going to start it, you got to follow through with it. And if you have a story that helps you with consistency, you got to do it, because not only is it better for other people, but it's better for you and your business for sure.
Right. There's some absolute gold in there. And I think the biggest part of it is, if we break it down, it's mentally preparing for how much work you have to do, right? I think that's the, people don't, you know, we talk about getting involved in real estate investing and achieving financial freedom. And even it's as simple as something as like losing weight or being healthy. Like, people go at things too quickly, and that they don't have the reality, like for someone like yourself, to say like this, no, this is going to take some time. And when you go into something and you do it for 6 months, like, I'm not seeing any results, of course you're going to quit, because you didn't have the right mindset going into it, right? So yeah. It's really important. And I completely agree. I think when I first started my podcast, for whatever reason, the algorithms, when I got to 50 episodes, which was roughly a year, it was not just a flash in the pan and, oh, he's, you know, he's not going away and you've been there for a year. That was the mark where I saw the sort of podcast taking off a little bit more. But yeah, consistency is super, super key. I've also done a meetup, and I also struggled with meetups because it's so much work in terms of the effort you need to put in. So yeah. I know you have been asked to speak at Meetup HQ, and you were able to talk to some of the engineers around the platform to maybe leverage it a little bit better. Do you want to talk a little bit about that for the listeners out there?
Yeah. All right. So when I was in Manhattan at Meetup headquarters, it was the day after I spoke in front of their top 150 meetup organizers. I went upstairs in the sixth floor and hung out with about 10 engineers. So we were in a huddle, if you will. We're all standing around, and I really enjoy getting around geeks. Like, I really like just that brainiac. It's almost the opposite of me, and I'm just always intrigued. So I was asking a lot of different questions. And I remember saying, like, out of all 150 of us that you flew here from around the whole world, why was I one of the speakers? Because I know a lot of other people that weren't a speaker that that in fact have a larger meetup than me. And so the engineers actually showed me a few different algorithms that help why my meetup was placed in front of people. So I think I was the only meetup in the state of Colorado that was considered, they call it a super group. And here's, I'm going to try to give you all four of the things that I learned from them, because there was four. I hope I can remember all of them. Maybe I just remember three. One of them was consistency, literally what we were just talking about. One of them was that you have a regular schedule of when you're going to meet. So we met weekly, every single week, 51 Thursdays a year, every day but Thanksgiving. And so that was a huge one. The second one was if you get the same people coming back. So if the same people who attended at this event end up coming to the next event, that boosts you in the algorithms huge. So having the same people continue to come over and over and over. And so what I did to help people come over and over and over, here's like a tip or trick for anyone who might be doing a meetup, is that story, that personal brand that we talked about earlier, I made sure that I had one, and I made sure that the meetup group had a story. And so every single time I would tell people, here's the reason why we meet weekly. It's because if you look at psychology of sales, it generally takes you to see somebody, meet somebody 6 times to 15 times before you can start doing business. And so I know that there's a lot of great meetups out there. I understand that there's a ton of awesome meetups, but most of them meet monthly. And if you go to those meetings, like, it's going to probably take you 6 to 15 months before you ever do a deal with anyone in the room. And then I would say, that's why, you know, the word because is a human psychology word, that anything following the explanation of something adds more credibility to it. So I say, that's why at this meetup, people keep coming back every single week, because they know that in just 6 weeks, they might be able to start doing deals with each other. And so I just created a story why mine was different, why I niched down. You know, if you have a podcast, you create a story of what your podcast does. You might, just for an example, you might say that there's a lot of podcasts out there that are helping operators. This is the only podcast that helps past investors be safe, or something like that. You know what I mean? And then you have your story different. So number two was that I had people coming back every single time, and it helped to have a story. The third one that I learned from the engineers up there was that the ratings and reviews. And I don't know all of the reasons why I had so many incredible ratings and reviews. Maybe it happens to be that I was meeting weekly, so I just had more events than any other group. But sometimes I would ask for reviews. Sometimes I would say, hey, at the end of this, leave a review. Let me know what you think about it, because I want to know if you enjoyed this speaker. And I would just say that in the benefit of the attendee. I want to know, I want the feedback, because I need to know if I should have the speaker come back again. So please, when we're done, leave an honest review. But apparently I had more 5-star ratings and reviews than almost anyone in the world. Like, it was insane. So the meetup headquarters, that was one of the biggest reasons that got them to put me as one of the speakers, because of that. But I think that it was because we were doing more events, right? We were doing more events more often. So like, if I was meeting weekly, I could get to that level 4 times as fast as other people. Another one that they said was, I can't remember. There's 3 good ones though. There's 3 really good ones.
You just went through 3. So you went to the regular schedule, which is really important, looking to have the story, the reviews and ratings, and the consistency of people coming back over and over again. And I think there might've been a 4th one, but I think that's so key, that the regular scheduling, which I know personally, I struggled when I first started my meetup when I moved to LA, because I wanted to try and get some exposure. And it was just, you know, it started costing me money, and it was a lot trying to also work a W-2 job. So consistency is super, super key. And you got to find what you're good at, right? You also got to know that, do you want to host events and do you want to be around other people, 30, 40, 50 people every single week? Does that sound like a lot to you? Does that sound like a drag? Well, if it does, then maybe choose a podcast, or maybe do a blog, you know, something where you don't have to be in front of people. So I think it's really, really key that, and it just goes back to consistency. So, but well done on the accolades there with getting all the reviews and getting me being asked to speak at Meetup HQ. That's awesome. So
thank you.
Yeah. So mate, I guess coming towards the end of the show here, what have you got in store for 2020 and beyond with the branding and the podcast and the meetups and the whole sort of tapestry or tool belt, as someone would say, that you've got at your disposal?
Perfect. I would, with our company, Blue Spruce Holdings, based on where we are in a market cycle and based on some of what is going on with coronavirus right now, we are probably taking at least 3 months to just wait. And instead of buying apartment communities off of a T12, I think we're going to at least wait 3 months and then start looking at the T3 and see, you know, if there was a dip. So I guess we've kind of got our tail between our legs just for the next 3 months. We're holding. If I was somebody who is brand new and hadn't done a deal, I think this is a great time to learn, because there's probably going to be some really good opportunities. But for us, we're taking 3 months off, and we're doing more. I'm launching my first YouTube channel. Mm-hmm. So I've had the podcast for a few years, two years or 3 years, and this would be my first YouTube channel. As far as what else we got going on? Coaching, consulting, still doing that. And I think this is a good time for people who are looking to brand to focus on that. And then for my meetups, we're doing all virtual meetups because of what's going on. But once it comes back out, we'll go back to weekly. I love the weekly meetups and we'll keep them at lunch. And as far as, I think that answers most of your questions. That's kind of what we're focused on in 2020.
No, so it sounds like, you know, what's the word? You know, like the trees where you not cultivate, but the word where you nurture the community that you've created, right? You're diversifying a little bit in terms of doing online meetups and you're doing a YouTube channel, but it's all still consistently around building a good community. I can definitely see from just talking to you, you really have a passion for that. And I think that has come probably why you've had so many awesome reviews and so many consistent people coming back is because you love what you do in terms of creating a community for other like-minded people to be successful, right? And I love what you said about the touches, you know, the six or seven times you meet someone that you're then are more likely to do a deal. I have heard, you know, other statistics out there with social media that you've got to, you know, with the different touches and you do in-person touches, which are really strong touches, but with sort of online touches, you got to like do like 22 or 25 now because it's just so much, right? You
know, it's completely growing. But 2 years ago when I started saying that, it was 6 to 15 but now online, just like you said, it's like 22, 24 touches is where it starts to be. So, which is cool because there was one of my past investors that, there was somebody who wasn't yet a past investor, but I let him know that I had a podcast and he told me that he listened to 60 episodes before he called me. So he listened to 60 and now he's one of our top past investors, but it took him more than the 20 that you're talking about because on these online things, it can take a little bit longer. So you got to really, that just adds to the thought about being consistent or maybe doing more than one episode per week if you can, instead of, you know, one episode a week if you have the opportunity to do it. So
and just to close that loop is really the podcasting and the branding and the digital assets that you create and more of your physical assets with Meetup. What it does is it compresses getting to know someone over a 5 or 6 year period into like 6 to 12 months, right? And the more content you have, the more you can compress that getting to know people, which is essentially what branding is, right? You get to know them enough because you've seen them often. Okay, I trust them because I've seen them so many times. And yes, I'm gonna invest or buy their widget or employ them, whatever they might be for their services. So yeah, it's really, really, really cool stuff. Mate, at the end of every show, we love to dive into a lightning round called the top 5 investing tips. You ready to get into it?
I'm ready.
Mate, what is the daily habit you practice to keep on track towards your goals?
Gratitude. That's the main one is just focusing on everything that I've been blessed with. Because when I focus on what's going wrong as an entrepreneur, every entrepreneur listening to this knows that that you get hit all the time. So I take time in the morning and in the evening, and sometimes I have to do it in the middle of the day to just focus on what I'm grateful for, and it changes my mind and gets me ready to go.
Completely agree with that. And I like how you are trying to catch yourself in the middle of the day if it starts getting a little stressful, just to like refocus. Okay, it's getting a little stressful today. What am I grateful for? You know, and then just going back into the whatever you're doing. Awesome answer. Question number 2, who is the most influential person in your career to date? I'm going to have a guess, but maybe you can tell me.
There's too many. Dang it. I take from everybody. You know, my mom is probably the most influential. Told me that I could do whatever I set my mind to. I believe that. But I've learned a lot from Rod Cleef, Joe Fairless, from you, from one of your partners, Andrew. I learn a lot from a lot of different people. I would say that I learned a lot from Russell Brunson, who owns ClickFunnels, and he talks a lot about psychology and persuasion. And then I read 30 books this year so far, and I learned tidbits for everything. So who were you going to guess, by the way?
Your dad. Oh, your stepdad.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah, my stepdad for sure. You're absolutely right. I think you're right. I should have used that answer. My face is red because I thought that was such an obvious answer. Oh, well.
Yeah, exactly. No, but we'll give it to you. Your parents are so important when growing up, and sounds like you had an incredible upbringing with them, you know, at your side, you know, showing you the way and challenging you to be more and do more. So well done. In your business, question number three, what is the most influential tool? And when I say tool, it could be a physical tool like a phone or a journal, or it could be a software that you use that you can't run the business every day without this particular tool. So what is it?
I'm going to say virtual assistants. Okay. I'm going to say building a team, and it's much easier to pay somebody who is going to take $3 to $7 an hour versus somebody who's going to take 12 to 20 or 25. I had an assistant that I paid $50 an hour in the US for a short time. But virtual assistants, being able to work with people in another country. One of my virtual assistants has an accounting degree. Mm-hmm. The other one has a finance degree. The other one, I have four. One has a business degree, and I'm paying them about $5-$6 an hour.
Wow. So it's incredible. That's awesome. And it's building teams, right? And the whole outsourcing overseas and globalization is definitely where a lot of entrepreneurs help scale their business because they can get out of their own way and they can hire people to do certain tasks that they just hate to do. So awesome stuff. In question number four, in one sentence, what has been the biggest failure in your career? What did you learn from that failure?
There's a lot. Shoot. Biggest failure would probably be the one that I'm most embarrassed about is our first conference that I hosted. I lost so much money. Like I lost a lot of money on that conference. And I told my partners that we were going to probably make something like $100,000.
Wow.
I expected 400 people to be there. We had 220, and I had to give a lot of the tickets away for free. And us, like at that time in our business career, we weren't in a place that we could lose very much money, and we lost, I think, like $40,000 on that. And wow. It blew my mind. I was embarrassed to and ashamed with my all my partners that I told them this was going to be like the coolest thing we ever did. And what did I take away from it? I took a lot away from it. I learned a little bit more about marketing, branding. I learned a little bit more about being able to utilize free resources like the social media algorithm that could allow me to get in front of more people and not have to pay. I learned not to put ads on the radio because I think I wasted $20,000 just on radio ads. That was a big part of it. At the same time, I know that it's important to get in front of people and to support people and help people and be the thought leader. So we tried it again. We lost some money and we tried it again. We finally started making money at these events. And I think it's important that anyone makes money. For a while, I thought to myself that it was better that this was like an investment. For mm-hmm. a while, I was thinking this was an investment, but reading the book Profit First, it really made me feel bad. And I started to just say, you know what? I shouldn't feel bad about profiting from an event. Like I shouldn't feel bad. Like that's the way that we keep our business in business. And so I changed a lot after that experience and reading that book. It's just so much. But maybe the biggest takeaway was I think I was actually worried about making money with an event deep down. I felt like if I made money at an event that I would be letting my audience down. And I had to get over that. So
interesting. Well, I will say, just to give you a bit of credit, that conferences are, you know, I know so many conferences the first couple of years, one or two years, they lose money. It's not till like it's not till like years three and four that they're starting to actually make money. And so I know very prominent conferences that in the first year, and maybe it's the second year they break even, the third year they're finally profiting, because you got to get your legs underneath you, right? You're gonna make so many freaking mistakes, and it goes back to that mindset on the beginning, where we spoke about earlier in the show. Like, if you've got to commit to 3 years on a podcast or 3 years on a blog, it's the same thing. You have to commit three times to a conference, 3 years in a row. The first couple of years you might lose some money, but you got to understand that you're going to lose the money in order to think that it's an investment for then when you do get to hit your stride in year three, year four, your fifth year, it's just, you know, going bananas and you're making bloody $500,000 every conference.
We were, yeah.
The third one made that. And that's fantastic, right? Like, you know, but looking back, imagine if I told you that before you started, do you think you'd beat yourself up as much? I don't think you would. Exactly.
No.
So it's just, you know, it's all hindsight 2020. I'm sure the embarrassment of it was massive, but man, you dusted your knees off and you got back on the horse. So well done. Big fella, last question before we wrap up the show is, where can people reach you to continue the conversation? They want to be in your sphere. Where do they go?
RaisingMoneyCoach.com.
RaisingMoneyCoach.com. All right, mate. Well, look, I want to thank you so much for jumping on today's show. I just want to reflect some of the cool nuggets and piece of advice that you're giving away. And I think the biggest thing for me is authenticity. I wrote that down earlier on in the piece. Having true authenticity in and around your brand will attract more leads, will attract more business, regardless of what you do, not just in the real estate space, but you know, you're helping some SEC attorneys create better brands. And I'm sure in and around that is their authenticity. Being consistent. I don't think we can drive that home enough. The consistency and authenticity are huge. And I guess that the last one is you're constantly learning. I think I just wrote that down at the end there. Sounds like you're an avid reader. You're constantly hungry for more knowledge. And you're also willing to look at your own failures as stepping stones towards the better future. So I hopefully did I leave anything out there?
No, that was awesome.
Awesome.
You crushed it.
Awesome, man. Well, look, I want to thank you again so much for jumping on the show. Enjoy the rest of your week. Wash your hands, and we'll catch up very, very soon.
Thank you.
Well, there you have another cracking episode jam-packed with some incredible advice from Adam. If you do want any of his incredible advice, please check him out all over social media. You can check out Triple Adam, Triple A, or Adam Adams. He is everywhere. Find him on Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn. You can get into his sphere and learn a little bit about more what he does and if he can help you with your own brand. I want to thank you all again for taking some time out of your day to tune in to continue to grow your financial IQ, because that's what we're all about here on this show. If you do like this show, the easiest way to give back is to get on iTunes and give the show a 5-star review. Simple and easy as that. And we're going to do it all again next week. So be bold, be brave, and remember, go give life a crack.